Okay, so in the next session, we are going to focus on the Water Act, as this is nothing but the one of the chapter or unit from the Environment Management subject. And we have already discussed about the MSIC rule, CIMA rule, Factor Act. Then in the previous lectures, we have discussed about the biomedical waste treatment, then solid waste treatment, etc. So this is one of the part of that particular unit only. So I'm going to discuss about the Water Act, and if time permitted, then we will discuss about the Air Act. So what exactly the Water Act contains? Water Act is nothing but the Water Prevention and Control of Pollution Act 1974, Rules 1975, and the SES Act is also included with Water Act. Then that act is called as Water SES Act, and the rule is 1978. So the first part clearly focuses on the prevention and control of the water pollution. So we all know what exactly the water pollutants are, what is meant by water pollution, and with reference to this act, how to control that water pollution or water pollutants. So the pollution may be defined as an undesirable change in the physical, chemical, or biological characteristics of air, land, and water, causing harmful effects on human life or other desirable species and cultural assets. So this is called as pollution, which may be an undesirable change, which is not desired as a natural phenomena. So that may be due to physical activity, that may be due to some chemical reactions, chemical activities, or due to biological activities. So if some infections are there due to some bacteria, then it is called as biological activity. If some chemicals are added or spillage or leakage in the water body, then it is called as chemical activities and water pollution. And due to some equipment operations, if some activities are done like size reduction activity, that may be filtration activity, that may be some mechanical operation, and due to that activity, if the water pollution is done, then it is called as due to physical characteristics. So that is depend on the conditions, depend on the criteria. But if that water is polluted, then it is called as pollution, right? So that pollution is maybe air pollution, that may be land pollution, and that may be water pollution. So in this lecture, we are focusing on the water pollutions. So pollution of environment is one of the most detrimental ecological crises that we are subjected today. So Water Act, that is Water Prevention and Control of Pollution Act 1974. So normally this Water Act is nothing but Water Prevention and Control of Pollution Act 1974. An act to provide for the prevention and control of water pollution and maintaining or restoring of wholesomeness of water for the establishment. So this act clearly mentioned that it is going to prevent and control the water pollution, to maintain or to restore the natural water for the establishment with a view to carrying out of the purposes aforesaid of boards. So boards is nothing but pollution control board, that may be state pollution control board, that may be central pollution control board. So state pollution control board, say for example, if it is for Maharashtra, then it is Maharashtra pollution control board, and central pollution control board is governed by the central government, and state pollution control board are governed by the state governments. For the prevention and control of water pollution, for conferring on assigning of such boards powers and functions relating to thereto, and for matters connected therewith. So it clearly mentioned that for controlling this water pollution, for preventions, guidelines of this water pollution, so government forms boards under the central government, the CPCB is formed, and under this central government and CPCB, with the help of state government, SPCB is formed. So these boards can govern these activities, can guide the students, guide the training peoples, guide the industries how to prevent and control the water pollution. So this is the definition which is involved in that water act, that is called as outlet. So what is outlet? Includes any conduit pipe or channel that may be open or closed, carrying sewage or trade effluent or any other holding arrangements which causes or likely to cause pollution. So the pipes or the channels which carries some effluent, trade effluent means it is industrial effluent, and it may be sewage. So if that pipe or channel carrying this sewage treatment or sewage effluent or trade effluent that may be open or closed form, then it is called as outlet. What is trade effluent? Includes any liquid, gaseous or solid substance which is discharged from any premises used for carrying on any industry operation or process or treatment and disposal systems other than domestic sewage. So if in terms of liquids, gases or solid substances which are discharged from the premises that company used for carrying on any industry operation or process or treatment and disposal system other than the domestic sewage. So this trade effluent doesn't include domestic sewage. So domestic sewage is different, and for that purpose sewage treatment plant is different. Now to treat this trade effluent, or normally it is called as effluent, it is treated by the effluent treatment plant. So sewage treatment plant is different and effluent treatment plant is different. Then pollution, definition of pollution in Water Act: such contamination of water, such alteration of the physical, chemical or biological operations of water, such discharge of any sewage or trade effluent or any other liquid, gaseous or solid substance in water, whether directly or indirectly, as may or is likely to create nuisance or render such water harmful or injurious to public health or safety, to domestic, commercial, industrial, agriculture or other legitimate users, or to the life, health and animals or plants or of aquatic organisms. So whatever the contamination, whatever the alteration in process, in the properties or the discharge from the sewage or trade effluent, so if that liquid, gas or solid impact on the health of your life or on the animals or on the environment, then it is called as pollution. So if the adverse impact of that particular water is on the health of human being or of animals or on the environment, then it is called as pollution. So section 3 and 4, constitution of CPCB and SPCB. So section 3 and 4 of Water Act guided how to form this Central Pollution Control Board and State Pollution Control Board. So this central government shall constitute a central board for the prevention and control of water pollution to exercise the power conferred on and to perform the functions assigned under this act. So whatever the functions, whatever the guidelines you have to form under the central government, and that constitutes central board. So it is generally called as CPCB, Central Pollution Control Board. So to prevent from or to control the any type of pollution, CPCB is formed, and to prevent any type of pollution at state level, SPCB will be formed. So section 4 gives us the state government shall constitute a state board to exercise the power conferred on and perform the functions assigned under this act. So whatever the functions required, whatever the functions are assigned under this act, that CPCB or SPCB should perform that functioning with reference to this section 3 and 4 respectively. Then section 16, functions of CPCB. So these are the main or major functions. advise central government on any matter concerning the improvement of the quality of water and the prevention, control and abatement of water pollution plan. So this is the first function, that the quality of water should be improved, then the prevention and control and abatement of water pollution should be planned. How to prevent the pollution, water pollution, how to control that water pollution, and what are the parameters which are involved with reference to that water pollution. So to execute a nationwide program for the prevention and control and abatement of water pollution plan, so that is another function. So CPCB should execute a nationwide plan, because it is at a national level, it is at a central level, so a nationwide program should be executed to provide technical assistance and guidance to SPCB. So Central Pollution Control Board is the body which is at national level, so that CPCB should guide to the state pollution control, because it is at state level. Plan and organize training of persons engaged in program for prevention, control and abatement of water pollution. So CPCB should plan and organize some trainings for the awareness, some trainings to execute the actual operations, how to prevent and control the water pollution. So to create the awareness, to have hands-on practice, to have some mock drills, these programs can be conducted. Then lay down, modify in constitution with SPCB the standards for the quality of water, stream or well. So some guidelines can be modified, some rules and regulation can be rectified, some rules and regulation can be skipped, or some parameters of the rules and regulation can be changed with the dialogue with SPCB. So depending on the situation, depending on the requirement, that modification can be done with the help of SPCB. Then collect, compile and publish technical and statistical data relating to water pollution and the measures devised for its effective prevention, control and abatement. So the collection of information regarding the water pollution, regarding the parameters which are involved under the water pollution, under the water pollutants, then compiling all this information from the various places. Say for example, at state level activity, that may involve majority of the districts. Under the district activity, that covered under the taluka places or village area, and under that village or taluka places again, there are different regions. So collection of information, then compilation of this information and to publish this technical and statistical data is one of the major activity which is done by the CPCB. Now if it is done at state level, then CPCB have to compile all this data at a national level, and then they can publish the technical and statistical data that the in this region or in this district or in this state, that the water pollution level is at high level. In some cases the water pollution is very low. So what are the causes, what are the activities which is run at the highest or the lowest, and then we can do some training programs, some mock drills or some activities to have a low level water pollution. Then section 17, functions of state pollution control board. So this state pollution control board, which is governed at state government, advise state government on any matter concerning the prevention, control and abatement of water pollution. That is one of the function that this SPCB, state pollution control board, for Maharashtra it is Maharashtra Pollution Control Board, that is nothing but MPCB. So this MPCB can advise state government, Maharashtra government, on any matter relating to the prevention and controlment of this water pollution. Inspect any control equipment, industrial plant or manufacturing process, and to take necessary steps for prevention, control and abatement of this water pollutions. So this MPCB can inspect any type of unit, any type of activity from that particular unit, any type of MIDC or anywhere in that particular state. Normally some MIDC, some district level or some regional level activities are allocated to a particular region office, and that region office members can inspect any type of unit as far as this water pollution is concerned. So they may find out some high level pollution in some of the industries. They may find out some very low level water pollution as far as this MPCP norms and maximum permissible levels are concerned. And depending on the inspection, they can ask the industry to increase the or to modify or to change the sewage treatment as well as the effluent treatment plant processes. Inspect sewage or trade effluent works and plans for the treatment of sewage or trade effluent and review plans, specification or other data. So I have already discussed that depending on the permissible levels, depending on the parameters, say for example pH, acidity, alkalinity, heavy metals, then BOD, COD, DO, etc. So there are a number of parameters which we have to check the water pollution level, and depending on that parameters and depending on the results find out from this effluent, CPCB or SPCB can guide us how to reduce that pollution. Lay down modify standards for sewage or trade effluent in the consultation with CPCB. Suppose if SPCB wants to modify some standards, want to change or rectify some standards or some labels, then they can have a dialogue with the CPCB concerns, and after consultation or valid points or valid inputs, they can modify or change that standards. Evolve economical and reliable methods of treatment, utilization in agriculture and disposal for sewage or trade effluent. So which one is the economical and reliable method? That is the one of the topic, because there are many methods that may be physical method, that may be chemical methods or some other electrical methods are also involved for the treatment of effluent as well as for the sewage. Nowadays there are different treatments available with latest technology for treating this sewage as well as the effluent. So we have to study these treatment methods from the technical point of view as well as from the economical point of view. If these treatments are economical, technically feasible and reliable, then we have to adopt these treatment methods. So utilization in agriculture and disposal for sewage and treatment effluent. So depending again on the parameters, if suppose that it doesn't or adversely affect on the particular agriculture area or in the farm, then you can utilize some of the sewage water as for the gardening purpose. That may be for the other purposes for farming, etc. But again, it is depends on the maximum permissible limits of the MPCB. Then perform other functions entrusted by the CPCB and state government. So from the other than the above functions, some other functions can be done by this SPCB with reference to the CPCB guidelines as well as the state government guidelines. Then section 18 and 19 focuses on the power to give directions and power of state government to restrict the applications of this act. So this section 18, power to give directions, that CPCB shall be bound by such direction in writing as the central government may give. So whatever the guidelines given by the central government, that should be followed by the state pollution control board, and this is nothing but the power to give directions. So CPCB is the higher authority. They can give the directions, they can give the guidelines, they can give some other types of training programs, policies, etc. to the SPCB, and SPCB should have to follow this. In a similar way, SPCB have some powers to give the directions to the industries or to the state government or to the MIDCs. Then section 19, power of state government to restrict the applications of the act. State government may restrict the application of this act to such areas as may be declared as water pollution prevention controlled areas. So whatever the areas which is declared by this MPCB or SPCB, water pollution prevention and control areas, for this area the state government guidelines and restrictions can be applicable. So this is the power of state government to restrict this application of this act and to restrict some activities in that particular WPCA, water pollution prevention control areas, as per section 19. Then section 20, power to obtain information. For the purpose of enabling a SPCB to perform the functions conferred on it by or under this act, the SPCB or any officer empowered by it in that behalf may make surveys of any areas and ditch and keep records of the flow or volume and other characteristics of any stream or well in such areas, and may take steps for the measurement and recording of the rainfall in such areas for the installation and maintenance for the purpose of gauges or other apparatus and works connected therewith, and carry out the stream surveys. So it is section 20 which can give us the idea regarding the power to obtain the information. So any person from the MPCB or SPCB can inspect, can conduct the survey to any area where he can or she can measure the different parameters from the majority of that streams, that may be from the sewage, that may be from the effluent, and depending on that parameters, that control or that instruction can be given to that particular company. Say for example, if the pH is very low, it means it is acidic. So how to control this acidic stream, how to neutralize this acidic stream? So some guidelines can be given by this SPCB persons. In a similar way, there are different parameters. Mainly the parameters like COD and BOD are the major concern, because this COD and BOD can give us the idea what exactly the level of water pollution is there. So depending on the COD, we can, or that SPCB can guide us how to control or reduce this COD also. That is one of the major parameters. There are 100 plus parameters to measure in the water pollution area, but normally we are measuring at least 15 parameters to check whether the water pollution is under control or not. Then section 21, it is power to take sample of effluent. So the SPCB person can take the samples anytime from the effluent of that particular industry, and that is with reference to the section 21. So that sample, now for this case it is a water sample, so you can take this water sample and you can collect this water sample from that effluent from the industry and can submit it to the government labs for the analysis purpose, to analyze the different parameters. Then section 22, power of entry and inspection. So I have already discussed that SPCB person can take entry in any type of unit, for in any type of area, or in any type of timing, that may be from shift 1, 2, 3, for the inspection purpose. So the inspection mainly is for the water pollution, for the sewage as well as for the effluent. Then section 23, prohibition on use of stream or well for disposal of polluting matters. So some prohibition on use of stream or well can be restricted from the SPCB person. Some disposal of polluting matters can be guided by that SPCB persons, and if the disposal techniques are not valid or illegal, then he can take the action on that particular unit also. No person shall knowingly cause or permit any poisonous, noxious or polluting matter determined in accordance with the such standards as may be laid down by the SPCB to enter into any stream or well or sewer or land. So you can't by the SPCB standards. We have to follow all these standards because in some cases, in some effluents, some poisonous or noxious or polluting matters is also included in that effluent, or in some cases in the sewage also some matters can be mixed. So first of all, we have to separate all these toxic or poisonous substances from this effluent, and then only you can add this effluent to the particular plant or treatment or for the storage for the mixing with the other streams or well. Then section 25 and section 26, consent to use and discharge of the water, valid up to expiry only. So application at the time of obtaining consent to establish, to operate an industry, operations and processes, and for the renewal. So you have to apply for this consent. You have to establish that consent to operate an industry, and then after that operations, that consent for the processes, and then for the renewal. So there is some time period that is nothing but the consent to establish, then consent to operate, and then consent for the process, and after expiry we have to renew all these consents. So for this consent you have to submit all the data which is related to the water pollution as per this section 25 and section 26 is concerned. So you have to submit these data or the application for the consents to the SPCB. Now conditions for water consent under Water Act: the daily quantity of trade effluent from the factory shall not exceed the specified in consent. So whatever the quantity, suppose for 1000 liters per day or 1000 meter cube per day, whatever the quantity specified in the consent, that should be used on the daily basis only, right? It should not exceed. The daily quantity of sewage effluent from the factory shall not exceed the specified in the consent. So that is for the trade effluent. Now it is for the sewage. So whatever the quantities are given in the consent, that should be followed on. Trade effluent treatment: the applicant shall provide comprehensive treatment system consisting of primary, secondary or tertiary treatment as it is warranted with reference to effluent quality, and operate and maintain the same continuously so as to achieve the quality of the treated effluent to the specified standards. So normally this trade effluent is treated as per the direction of ETP, that is effluent treatment plant, and normally this effluent treatment plant consists of three levels, like primary, secondary and tertiary. And at the primary level you have to treat the effluent at primary level only, that is with the help of some mechanical operation, that may be included some screening operations, that may be some filtration operation, etc. In secondary operation, normally some biological treatments are included in the secondary treatment, and after that the finishing operation, finishing treatment, that is called as tertiary treatment. So depending on the qualities, depending on the characteristics of the treatment, these primary, secondary, tertiary treatments are designed. So conditions for water consent: the standards pertaining to the following. Some of the parameters are that pH, suspended solids, BOD, 3 days procedure at 27 degrees Celsius, then COD, oil increase. So pH is stands for potence of hydrogen ion concentration. So potence means strength or power. So what is the power of hydrogen ion concentration? That power normally we describe in terms of pH scale, that is 0 to 14. So 0 to 7 is the acidic range, and from 7 to 14 it is the basic range. So when pH is lowering towards the 0, it means it is going to become acidic, and if it is going towards 14, then it is going to become basic or alkaline. So the standard is nothing but the ideal condition is 6.8 to 7.2, that pH is very good. So if the some of the suspended solids, so the solids which are suspended in the water are called as suspended solids. So some solids may be in the form of TSS, that is total suspended solids, and some solids in the form of TDS, that is total dissolved solids. So some solids can be dissolved in the water quickly, and that is called as TDS, and some solids are not dissolved in a water, or the solubility of that solid with water is very less, so that can be suspended, and that is why it is called as TSS. Then BOD is a biological oxygen demand. That parameter, it may have 5 days, 3 days, and 10 days methods to detect this BOD level. And the main or the common method is BOD 3 days 27 degrees Celsius method. So how much oxygen is required, how much oxygen is demanded for completing the biological treatment, for completing the conversion of these biological activity, biological components, that is nothing but the BOD. And when we are concerning with this BOD, that is chemical oxygen demand. So this chemical oxygen demand or COD indicates the level of water pollution, because these chemicals are normally, majority of the chemicals are not biodegradable, and that is why they are retained in that water, and that is why the water pollution level can be judged by these COD parameters. Then some oil and grease can be present in the water pollution, because depending on your process operations which are involved in your industry, some oils or greases can be added in the water stream, and that is why we have to check the oil and grease levels also. So all these parameters can adversely affect on the river bodies, on the well bodies, or the other streams of water bodies where there's aquatic animals are present. So this can directly affect on the fish or the animals which are present in the water. Then disposal, the treated treated effluent should be reused for gardening or irrigation in the plant premises, and that is depending on the parameters again. If all the parameters are under control or less than the maximum permissible limit, which is related to the MPCB or SPCB, then you can use this treated red effluent for the gardening purpose or for the irrigation purpose. Then sewage effluent, the application shall provide comprehensive treatment system consisting of again primary, secondary, and tertiary treatment, and is warranted with reference to the effluent quality, and operate and maintain the same continuously so as to achieve the quality of the treated effluent to the specified standards. Now in this sewage effluent, the sewage effluent is nothing but the outlet of the water from the toilet and bathroom especially. So whatever the water coming from the toilets or bathrooms, and that is treated as a sewage. So sewage normally consists of the biological components. They are the components, that is chemical components, are very less in the sewage, and vice versa case is there for the treated effluent. In the treated effluent, the chemical components are more, or the heavy metals are more, and that is why the treatment methodology for the sewage treatment as well as for the effluent treatment is different. Normally if your sewage effluent is at lower side or the quantity is very less, then that can be treated at the common sewage treatment facility of the government. In the similar way, at some places a common effluent treatment facility is also available to treat the effluent from your area, from your region, from your MIDC at a central place. If the effluent or the sewage is treated at central place, then that ETP is called as CETP, that is common effluent treatment plant, and the sewage treatment plant is called as common sewage treatment plant by the which can be governed by the state government. Then disposal, treated sewage effluent shall be used for on land for gardening or irrigation. So normally this treated sewage is very much useful as compared to the treated effluent or treated effluent, because in this sewage effluent, in the treated sewage effluent, the characteristics of fertilizer is more, and that is why it can be directly used to the land for the gardening or irrigation purpose as compared to the treated effluent. The industry should monitor effluent quality regularly. The applicant shall comply with the provisions of the Water Sales Act 1977 and rules thereunder. So we have to pay the taxes, and that taxes is nothing but is called cess, and that is why this Water Sales Act come into exist from 1977. Water Act is from 1974, and after 3 years this Water Sales Act, that is 1977, comes into exist. So for the water tax, for billing of this water payment, this Water Sales Act is the major concern. So what is Water Sales Act? An act to provide for levy and collection of cess on water consumed by persons carrying on certain industries and by local authorities, and to control water pollution constituted under this Water Act. So this is nothing but the levy is the word, actually it is from the British British government, but nowadays we can say that it is nothing but the tax. So the tax provision for the water is nothing but the water cess. So it can be consumed or utilized for the controlling or the prevention activities for the water pollution. So to control that water pollution, to purchase some equipments, to purchase some technological changes for controlling this water pollution, this water cess can be utilized. So for maintaining or the installation of some of the equipments or the pipelines purpose, this water cess can be used. Local authority means a municipal corporation or a municipal council. So for Nasik, it is a Nasik Municipal Corporation. For Pune, it is Pune Municipal Corporation. And likewise for all the municipal corporation, that it is called as local authority. Industry includes any operational process or treatment and disposal system, effluent or trade effluent, but does not include any hydropower unit. So excluding the hydropower unit, all the types of operations or the process units are called as industries. So this CES Act is applicable to all industries. So section 3 gives us the idea what exactly the levy and collection of this CES. CES shall be payable by every person carrying on an industry. Every local authority shall be calculated on the basis of water consumption by such person or local authority. So at residential level also we are paying this CES, but the commercial and residential charges are different. So for the industries, for the MIDCs, the charges for this water billing or water cess are different, and for the residential or semi-commercial, these charges are different. So the schedules and columns are given for these purposes, for any of the purposes specified in column 1 of schedule 2, at such rate not exceeding the rate specified in the corresponding entry in column 2 therefore. Second A, where any person carrying on any industry and any local authority consuming water for domestic purpose is payable the cess as given in column 3 and schedule 2. So this section 2 and schedule 2 is giving the idea regarding how much money have to pay for this water cess. Then in section 3, where any local authority supplies water to any persons carrying to any specified industry or to any other local authority, and such persons or other local authority is liable to pay cess in respect of the water so supplied, then the local authority first mentioned shall not be liable to pay such cess in respect of such water. Suppose if second local authority is supplying the water, it means you have to pay the water cess to that the second authority who is going to supply the water to industry or to the residential area. Then section 4, affixing of meters. So to measure how much consumption of water is there on the daily basis, on the hourly basis, so some meters, that is called as water meter, should be installed at your place, in your industry, at your home, etc. For the purpose of measuring and recording the quantity of water consumed, every person carrying on any industry and every local authority shall affix meters of such standards and at such places as may be prescribed, and it shall be presumed that the quantity indicated by the meter has been consumed, as the case may be, until the contrary is provided. So normally at each and every industry the water meter are fixed to measure the consumption of water on the daily basis. Then section 5, furnishing of returns. Every person carrying on industry and every local authority liable to pay the cess under section 3 shall furnish such returns in such forms, at such intervals, and containing such particulars to such officers or authority as may be prescribed. So we have to furnish returns in a specific form, with specific interval time, with specific particulars to the specific officers. Section 5, rebate. Where any person or local authority liable to pay cess under this act install any plant for the treatment of sewage or trade effluent, such person's local authority shall, from such date as may be prescribed, be entitled to rebate of 25% of the cess payable him, provided that the person or local authority shall not be entitled to the rebate if he or it consumes water in excess of the maximum quantity as may be prescribed. So this is the condition for a rebating of 25%, that you have to consume less water as compared to the maximum quantity which is prescribed in the Water Cess Act. Second, fails to comply with any of the provisions of section 25 of Water Prevention and Control of Pollution Act 1974 or any of the standards laid down by central government under Environment Protection Act. So if you are not going to comply or fail to comply the provisions which are provided in the Water Act as well as in the Environment Protection Act, then you are not eligible for this 25% rebate under this section 5 for the cess payable. Then section 3, reference, and schedule 2. So the purpose of which water is consumed. So here in this table it is clearly indicate what is the purpose of this water consumption. Industrial cooling, spraying in mine pits or boiler pits. So this is the purpose of water consumption. Then the maximum rate under subsection 2, 5 paisa per kiloliter, and here the maximum rate under subsection 2a, that is 10 paisa per kiloliters. So depending on your consumption, these charges are fixed, and nowadays these charges are changed. So this table can give us the idea what type of consumption is there, what is the purpose of water consumption, what is the maximum rate under section 2, and what is the maximum rate under section 2a. So domestic purpose, the charges are less as compared to the industrial charges. Then the processing, whereby water gets polluted and the pollutants are easily biodegradable, non-toxic, both non-toxic and not easily biodegradable, then the rates are different. Then for processing, whereby water gets polluted and other water pollutants are not easily biodegradable, here easily biodegradable, now here it is not easily biodegradable, here it is non-toxic, here it is toxic, here it is both non-toxic and not easily biodegradable, now in this case it is toxic and not easily biodegradable. So if the toxic category is there and not easily biodegradable, then the charges are more, because for the toxic category we have to adopt some treatment for the toxic chemicals, and that is why the charges are more. With reference to section 3, levy and collection of cess, the cess shall be payable by every person carrying on an industry and by every local authority valid up to expiry. The SPCB, the purpose of water consumption and the rate of cess refer schedule 2. So we have to pay this taxes through municipal corporation to the Pollution Control Board. Standards of the meters and places where they are to be fixed. For the purpose of measuring and recording the quantity of water consumption, reconsumption, every consumer shall affix meter, venturi meters or orifice meters which indicates records is conformity with the standards laid down by the ISI or specified by the board. So there are some meters like Venturi and Orifice. These are the instruments which can record or measure the flow rate. So in terms of liter per hour, liter per minute, liter per second, etc. So that may be a Venturi meter, that may be Orifice meter, which can measures the flow rate, and this flow rate can be converted into quantity of water then with the help of density. So if the 10 liter per hour is the flow rate for that particular company, then the we are using this water. So the density of water is 1000 kg per meter cube. So you can convert this liter into meter cube, and we can multiply this flow rate into density, and we get the quantity of water. So nowadays some digital meters are there which can directly gives us the idea how much quantity of water is used, and in that also some technological changes are also there. With the help of chip only you can record, you can measure, you can observe the day wise, hour wise, month wise, water wise consumption of water from that particular company, from that particular MIDC. So if you observe some more consumption or very less consumption, then you can check whether the consumption of water in the last month, what exactly the consumption is there, and why now it is increasing or why now it is decreasing. So you can ask to the industry also what are the changes they have made in the processes where the water consumption is more or less. Every consumer shall provide a separate meter for assessing the quantity of water used for each of the four purposes mentioned in column 1 and schedule 2 of this act. So there are some purposes and quantity of water used are mentioned in the schedule 2. Meter shall be affixed at the entrance of the water supply connection within the premises. So at the entrance normally the water meters are fixed, so that municipal corporation or the pollution control board person can check your meter anytime. Then the section 4, furnishing of these returns. Every consumer shall furnish on or before 5th of every calendar month to assessing authority a return in form 1 showing the quantity of water consumed in the previous month. If the consumer fails to submit the return, the assessing authority or the officer authorized in this regard shall issue a notice in form 1A. So you have to fill the returns before 5th of every calendar in the form A, and if that is not the case, then that authority can be give you a notice in the form 1A. Then section 6, rebate. Where a consumer install any plant for the treatment of sewage or treated effluent, such consumer shall be entitled to the rebate under section 7A from the expiry of 15 days from the date on which such plant is successfully commissioned and so long as it is functions. So you have to go for the installments for the effluent treatment plant or the sewage treatment plant, and you are adding this facility to treat your sewage or the effluent in your premises. So this reduces the load of the sewage treatment plant or the effluent treatment plant of the government, and that is why they are giving you the rebate. So after commissioning, after successful running of that particular plant, and depending on the expiry or the duration or the life of that particular plant, the rebate can be given, provided that the consumer shall not be entitled to the rebate if he consumes water excess of the maximum quantity. So these are the two conditions which are the conditions which is similar to the Water Act 1974. In these conditions clearly mentioned that you have to consume less quantity of water as compared to the maximum quantity specified in the column 3 of first schedule. And second, if you fail to comply any of the provision from this Water Act or the Environment Protection Act, then you are not eligible for this rebate. Then first schedule clearly mentions that name of the industry, category and maximum quantity of water. So this is first chemical industry. Category is caustic soda. In that, mercury cell process or membrane process can be used for the caustic soda category under the chemical industry. Then maximum quantity of water can be used, 5 cubic meter per ton of caustic soda. So if your plant is using 10 ton caustic soda, then you can understand that 10 into 5 cubic meter, that is 50 meter cube per plant can be utilized. Then 5 cubic meter per ton of caustic soda producing, that is including cooling water. So here it is excluding cooling water and here including cooling water. Then that process may be membrane process, that may be mercury cell process. For the textile industry, man-made fiber, nylon or polyester, 170 cubic meter per ton of fiber produced. So this much of water can be utilized by this textile industry. So you can understand this chemical or textile industries are consuming more water as compared to the other companies. Furnishing returns in form 1. So compliance of role 4. Processing authority showing the quantity of water consumed in the previous months on or before 5th of every calendar to the SPCB. So for the Maharashtra, it is MPCB. You have to submit this form 1. That is nothing but the written furnishing. Thank you. So this is the overall idea or the overview of Water Act 1974 and Water Cess Act 1977. So we can't discuss each and every section, each and every schedule, each and every rule under this act and rule, because we have to cover, we have to take overview of this Water Act or our Water Cess Act. And likewise, even that if Air Act is there, if calcium carbide rule is there, whatever the types of rules or act is there, we have to take the overview of that particular act and rule. That is nothing but the salient features of